Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. Grace and peace be unto all of you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. On behalf of the family, thank you so much for being here this afternoon. I've been thinking a lot about this family and what they've been through the last number of weeks. And I was thinking earlier today how hard it is for them to go through a service like this two times. There was a service in Michigan a little while ago, and that, in my way of looking at it, was a gift to that part of the family and that circle that knew Stefan there. And you represent another circle, so it's kind of like, to me, a two-way gift. You're here to support this family, let them know that you love them and care for them. And it's a gift to you to be able to walk you through what they have felt and what they've gone through. I've got to tell you at the beginning that I didn't have an opportunity to know Stefan, and that's probably a great loss for me. Everything that I've heard about him and seen of him, I think, boy, there's a young man that I would have loved to have known. So competent, a good-looking young man, was well-versed in so many areas, so much promise, so much ahead. And the only way that I can describe it, it just doesn't seem fair. Even as a pastor, I would tell you, it just doesn't seem fair. And it raises all kinds of questions for us, doesn't it? About life and about death, and about God. But it seems to me this is a safe place to ask those questions, to kind of think about it, and just to reflect on the importance of life and the importance of the relationships that we have. So you are kind of a testimony to part of that relationship with this family, because your presence here shows your love and tells all of us what's really important. So I want to tell you kind of what we're doing here. I always tell folks we're in a sanctuary, and I love that because that means this is a safe place for us to be. It's a safe place to cry, to laugh, to just kind of be ourselves. We can feel whatever we want. This is a safe place. There are no wrong emotions, no wrong feelings, no wrong answers, and no wrong questions. This is just a place for us to be, a safe place. So part of what we're doing today is we're remembering Stefan, and we're remembering a lot of good things about him and the interactions that some of you have had with him, and certainly for the family, they're reliving all of this all over again. But in some ways, that's part of the process of grief, and that's part of the blessing of walking through this again and again, as hard as it is. But we're also here to look to God for strength. I don't know how anybody could manage to walk through the death of a child or any kind of death in a family without being connected to our Heavenly Father. I just don't know how to do it. I've experienced it myself a number of times with family, and I could not face another day if it were not for the strength of God and His Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who would walk us through whatever it is that we have to walk through. We cannot imagine anyone else's heart. I can look at you as a family, and I can imagine, but I can't possibly know what each of you are feeling in your heart this day or any of these days. But I know that God does. And God will be with you. He will be with you today, and He'll be with you in the days to come. That I believe, and that I trust in. So let's come to God in prayer and ask Him to bless our time together, shall we? Gracious and loving Father, we thank you for these moments that we spend together. We desperately need you. We need your strength. We need your comfort. We need your presence in our lives. And Lord, I would recognize that for some of us here, that's kind of an odd thought. Maybe we're not used to relying on you or reaching out to you. And yet, for me, I don't know how else we would do this. So I ask you to be present today. I ask you to open our hearts and our minds by your Spirit to hear the possibilities of your voice inside us. I pray for strength for this family. I pray for every single one of them that you would just give them an extra portion of your love and your grace and that you would pour your Holy Spirit into each of them. And then, Father, for all of us, as we come into this place, into this sanctuary, and even in a service like this, we're reminded sometimes of other losses that we've had. And I would pray that you would bring those losses to mind, that we would process that even in the course of a service like this today. And then would you fill us with your strength and with your love? We pray it in Christ's precious name. Amen. Well, the habit of this particular church and the Christian church is usually that we sing, even at a service like this, and sometimes it seems like that's an impossible thing to do. But we're going to sing together, and part of that is that we will be of one voice and one mind as we sing. We're going to sing a great hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. And I would ask us to stand together as we sing, please. And the words will be on the screen. Joyful, joy. Amen. You may be seated. I realize that probably for some of you it's rather odd that we sing a song about joy in the midst of a service like this, but it goes along with everything else that I have been saying. As a Christian community, we have hope. We trust that there's more than just this world. And this hymn, there's a great line in it. That says, melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. And I was looking at that earlier today. Sometimes when we sing hymns, we kind of sing the tune. Do you know what I mean? We don't pay much attention to the words. We have a couple of phrases that we sing. But there is so much packed into these hymns, so much good theology, and so much source of strength for us. And I love that this hymn reminds us that we can keep going. Death does not mean the end for us. We can keep going. We can keep going as a family and as an extended family. There's more to life, and God provides all of that for us. I'm very, very grateful for that. It's a good reminder. Well, I would ask Stefan's siblings to come up, and they're going to share the scriptures with us today.
Reading from the book of Lamentations, book 3. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I'll wait for him. Lord is good to those who hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. For no one is cast off by the Lord forever. Though he brings grief, he will show compassion. So great is his unfailing love, for he does not willingly bring affliction or grief to anyone.
Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Revelation, chapter 21. I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, see, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them as their God. They will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. And the one who was seated on the throne said, see, I am making all things new. Also he said, write this, for these words are trustworthy and true. Then he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water as a gift from the spring of the water of life. For those who conquer will inherit these things, and I will be their God, and they will be my children.
Thank you. Well, we have just witnessed that the scriptures have a profound effect on us. When we're reading, sometimes the word of God, it touches our heart and our mind in a way that surprises us at times. I want to make just a few comments about the scriptures that you shared, because they're really quite wonderful. And within them, there is this phenomenal hope for all of us if we choose to believe them. The passage from Lamentations, that opening line is just so wonderful. It says, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. And if we just even stop there and I don't know you, so I don't know what your thinking is about God. But in that passage and in that line, we are reminded at the very outset that God is a good and a loving God who is at the center of everything that happens in our lives. I don't believe that God orchestrates negative things, but I think God is always there in the middle of it, trying to help us figure out what has happened and how we can maneuver through it with his love and grace. And that passage in Lamentation reminds us that God is a God of compassion and love and care, and that all of those things will never fail us. The 23rd Psalm that Andrew read is another great reminder of who God is. And again, I can't presume to know how you look at God or whether you think about him at all. But let me tell you that the 23rd Psalm is what I would refer to as God's job description. And in that little passage, we have a reminder that God takes care of us here on this earth. God takes care of us in the transition from here to there. And if there is heaven, then at the end of the 23rd Psalm, we're reminded that God takes care of us there too. And so we're reminded at the beginning of that psalm, I think David was probably a shepherd when he wrote it. It was King David, but he was a young shepherd boy, probably in his early teens. I assume that at the end of the day, he had the sheep safely tucked away, and he was just thinking about life, looking at the expansive Judean sky, thinking about how small he was and how large the universe is, and just kind of contemplating the way young people do sometime. I wonder what life will be like. I wonder what my life will be like. Who's in charge? What's going to happen? And I think that's when he came across these thoughts. And he said, well, the Lord is my shepherd. I'm a shepherd. I take care of sheep. The sheep don't have to worry about anything because I take care of them. I have the implements that will always provide for them. And if they get into danger, I'm always there for them. And the great line in that is the second line that reminds us that God leads us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. In other words, God's role in our life always is to lead us in a way and to guide us in a way that will be pleasing to him. Well, you think about what that kind of a life looks like. When you think about it with Stefan's life, his life was full. Again, I didn't know him, but just what I have read and gleaned from him, his life was packed. It was packed with energy and interest in all kinds of things. I mean, it's really quite quite unbelievable when you read sort of the statistics of his life that we find in the program today. He was interested in absolutely everything. And there was a depth to him at a 17-year-old that is, to me, really quite remarkable. But I think that that's part of what God puts in us. He puts that spirit in us to guide us in a path that is always pleasing to him. Then I think when David, this young shepherd boy, thought about death, he wondered what that would be like. And he said, well, if I take care of my sheep, I walk them through darkness, I go through a valley with them, and the sheep are never afraid because they trust me, and I would never let any harm come to them. So then thinking about God, he went, well, I have a heavenly shepherd. Now we call him God. David called him a heavenly shepherd, and that shepherd would never let anything, no harm come to him. And so David says, well, even if I walk into the valley of death, into that shadow of death, even if I go to any kind of darkness, I don't ever have to be afraid, because that heavenly shepherd will always take care of me, will always watch over me. So in the transition from here to heaven, there's what we would call a dark valley. And again, if we were to have a conversation about death, we often think about death as a darkness, don't we? Because we don't know a lot about it. It's rather frightening, I think, to most of us. But David answered it fairly well. He said, well, if you go into that darkness, and whether it's the darkness of death or the darkness of anxiety or illness or whatever it is, we don't have to be afraid because we've got this heavenly shepherd who takes care of us. Now, the interesting thing is that the sheep weren't afraid, the actual physical sheep weren't afraid if the shepherd took them anywhere. Why? Because they got used to his voice. All they heard all day, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, was that shepherd's voice either talking or singing. And so when the sheep heard that voice, they'd come out and follow him wherever he went. Well, the key for us is to not have that anxiety and fear of the darkness, is to get to know our heavenly shepherd. And we need to be able to identify his voice and feel his presence in our lives. And then we don't have to be afraid of the darkness of death. And then at the end of that psalm, we're reminded that God is there. And the blessings of being with God forever keep coming. They overflow. And that's the way that the psalmist describes it. Well, the last passage that Keiko read was from Revelation 21. And again, it is such a wonderful picture, because if we're ever trying to figure out what heaven looks like, there it is. It's the most magnificent picture that we can probably put together of where I believe Stefan is now. And it was a vision that was given to John when he was quite old, the gospel writer John. And God said to John, look, I'm going to show you something, and it's going to be quite remarkable. I want you to write down what you see, because this is really going to be something. And so this is what John describes. He said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. Well, what is he describing there? So God, in his gentle grace, showed John something that looked familiar, and yet it was different. So he says, it's something that I recognize, and yet there's something different about it. Now, I always think, isn't that remarkable if that's the image we have of heaven? That which we recognize gives us comfort. And then there's that great little line, there was no longer any sea. Well, why would that be? Well, in the ancient mind, the sea represented turbulence. There was, you know, if you go through the ocean, it's always moving, right? It never stops, keeps going, going, going. And so the image, the metaphor of heaven is there is no sea because it's a place of absolute peace. And at some level, isn't that what we're all looking for in this life? We're looking for peace. We try to find it in all different kinds of ways. But ultimately, the only peace we will ever find is the peace that God gives. And God gives it ultimately in heaven. Well, as John continues to look in this vision, he sees a city coming down in the middle of what he's looking for, looking at. And as he continues to look, he recognizes that that city is Jerusalem. Well, why Jerusalem? Well, if you think about it again, for the ancient mind, where did God live on earth? God lived in the temple, and the temple was in Jerusalem. So again, if God was going to be present in heaven in this vision, he would have to be identifiable. So it was by the city of Jerusalem. And then he hears the voice, and the voice, John says, comes out from the center of that city. And the voice says, I will wipe away every tear from your eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for all that belongs to the old order. So there's that great word of God, that assurance. And here's how I imagine that. Stefan comes to the gate of heaven. God opens the gate and he sees him. Stefan is crying. Now, if heaven is such a great place, why would he be crying? Well, he's crying because he left what he knew. He left his family. He left all kinds of things undone, all kinds of things that were the potential for him. Don't you think that would cause tears? And God, in his grace, according to that scripture, reaches into the folds of his robe, takes out a handkerchief and says, Stefan, let me wipe those tears away. You won't need them here. This is a place where there is no crying, there's no mourning, there's no death, no pain, no illness. All that is left in the world that you left behind. So in my way of looking at it, Stefan is safe and secure. He's with his God in heaven. And if we believe in God at all, then that can't be bad. So the grief that we have is very real. And the grief is about each of you and about all of us, right? But the grief is about our loss, and it's about our pain. It's about what we feel. But let me tell you that for Stefan, there's a whole new adventure that has begun, an adventure that we can't even put into words. He's safe. He's secure. God took care of him. So we don't have to have that grief and pain for him, but we have it for ourselves. And that's the reality of our faith. That's what we trust. That's what we believe. So is it okay to grieve? Absolutely. The tears are very appropriate because we're missing somebody that was so important, that we loved so much. But in all of these scriptures, there's that one constant reminder that God is there, God is compassionate, God is loving, God is gracious, and he will do that with this family, and he will do that with all of us in whatever darkness we have, whatever pain we have, whatever loss we have, whatever we're walking into or walking through right now. We serve an amazing God who loves us beyond anything that we can put into words. Well, may God bless these thoughts to our hearts and to his purpose for our lives. Now, Alan, you're going to come up and, do you think, and share a song with us.
About a month ago, I was out at a, 2 months ago, I was out at a ceremony at the school that Stefan was going to, and it was a ceremony where you exchange rings, and I was able to give him my ring at this school that I had before, and he got his class ring, and I remember that just before he went to his place in the church, and I sat where people were sitting. There were guests. His last comment to me there was, "I know you're going to embarrass me, but I just want you to know that I'm going to be fine." So in that spirit, I thought I would not disappoint him, and just do this this song. Today would be our last, that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb, I can't feel anymore, praying you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as long as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne
tonight. Stefan's text on Tuesday, June 6th, at 7:42 a.m. Hi, Mama. I pick up my suit. Two more finals left, then I'll be done. I'll pack up my room, go to prom, then I will fly back to California on Thursday. I will send you a picture. Can't wait to see you. Love, I love you. Smiley face. Wednesday, June 7th, around 7:30 a.m. As my daughter Keiko was driving me to work that morning, I get a phone call from the upper school headmaster. That phone call that shattered our lives, changed our lives, put our lives on hold. With Keiko in the car, she pulled over. We cried, we hugged, we screamed. We didn't know what to do, we were desperate. And it all seemed it was yesterday. Endless thank you to everyone for the outpouring of kindness, support, and love. Each of your phone calls, messages, cards over the past month has given my family and me the strength to wake up every morning and live every day at the fullest, and leave everything and give everything 100%, because that's exactly how Stefan would have done things. I can't believe it's been over a month since the day you departed from our lives, but only physically, because Stefan is here in spirit and forever in our hearts. Stefan, my angel, looking upon me, upon us, there are no words to describe how truly an amazing son, brother, and friend you were. You touched so many lives and left behind so many plans, so many dreams. You were definitely the hardest working young man I know that I ever met. And if you read the program, you will agree with me. I remember last summer, I came to say goodnight to Stefan. And of course, he was on the table on his laptop, not playing video games like a regular teenage boy. Instead, you'll find him with a couple laptops, coding, programming. And he said, I can't go to bed yet. I have a deadline to have this app done by the end of this week, as we're making a huge announcement this coming Monday. I've been working on this for the last 14 hours. This doesn't sound like a regular 16-year-old. This sounds like some of us. This is how he gave 100% to everything he did. He was never afraid to try new things, learn new things, as he found Chinese language to be his new joy, his new challenge. He taught himself new computer languages all the time, and most important, he taught his peers, even adults, how to program. One day, between giggles and laughs, while having dinner with him in Michigan at his favorite restaurant, he told me, and almost word by word, I need to study hard, I need to work hard, and I need to go to a good university. Because one of my dreams and plan is to own my own company and to have Andrew work beside me as my partner. Andrew is crazy smart. Keiko will do my PR because she's so good with people and everyone likes Keiko. Hannah will do HR. She gets mad easily, so no one will ever mess with her. Papi will be my advisor. He'll get the funding, He'll take pictures. And Mama will cook for everyone in the office and teach yoga. That's how he sees us. And after I become successful, I will buy myself a small house on a lake in the middle of nowhere where I can code all day, blast my classical music. And if you came earlier, you probably heard background music, and that was his playlist. He was crazy about classical music. I will play my trumpet and go fishing and hunting every day. Then I will have a penthouse in New York or in San Francisco. That's where I'll have my parties. I will own a Ford pickup truck for the lake and a Maserati for the city. And after I make enough money, I will buy my family a house in Hawaii or anywhere they want. And I will buy you your Audi A6 that you always want to have. This is how hard worker he was. He was always full of energy, kind, loving human being. He knew how to make everybody laugh, everybody that was around us laugh and entertain us with magic shows, ventriloquist shows, singing on stage, and at camp gatherings, singing in the shower, which drove Hannah crazy. Thank you for all those unforgettable hugs, kisses, laughs, your adorable dimples every time you laugh, which made your siblings jealous because they didn't have them. I will forever remember the touch of your skin as you always like to be, like your back being scratched before you went to bed. I will miss making your favorite food, fried rice and steak with mushrooms. I could go on and on and on, but it will be here all day long. But I think by just talking a little bit about him, you probably got a good picture of what an amazing young man he was. He's in heaven right now. One more angel to take care of us. And it makes my heart happy because he's in heaven. I can just picture him right now. One more time, he gather people around him, boy, girls, young, old, men, women. And probably he's teaching them how to code. Maybe he has 3 laptops, 2 screens, and just teaching them how to do that. And have you ever asked yourself, what will heaven be like? Well, heaven is a place more wonderful than we can ever begin imagine. It is a place of joy and beauty, of peace and happiness that will never end. Why? Because heaven is also a place where there will be no sin or suffering, no sorrow or pain. It's a place where there will be no quarrels or disagreements, no disappointments or weeping, because there will be nothing there to make us sad. And in heaven, we will never do anything to displease God. We will then know what perfect joy is. Everything that now makes us groan will finally be done away with. And we will find ourselves in the very presence of God, where the purest and truest kind of joy is possible. In heaven, we will also have perfect knowledge. We will have no more unanswered questions, no confusion, and no more need to walk by faith rather than by sight. We will live in perfect comfort. We will love God perfectly and will be loved perfectly by Him. His love will engulf us forever. Stated simply, heaven is a place of perfect joy forever. And we know that heaven is brighter and more beautiful for having you there, Stefan. Life is a gift. Stefan is a gift to us, to my family, to me, and to everyone that he has touched in his life. And I say this because he lives in my heart and in my soul. I would like everyone to hold hands, to amplify our love so Stefan can feel our love strongly. As we hold hands, please repeat after me. Stefan, we love you. Stefan, we love you. And we're here together. To say that you will always be remembered. Say that we always be remembered. And that you will always be in our hearts.
That you'll always be in our hearts.
May you always be happy.
May you always be happy.
And may your body and spirit rest in peace.
Body and spirit rest in peace.
Amen. I know you are with me because you're my guardian. My guardian angel, and I will see you again. So tonight, as you get ready for bed, I'll invite each one of you to take a moment and to look up in the sky. Perhaps all those little white lights are not stars, but rather openings in the sky where Stefan is shining down to let us know he's happy. Amen.
Last week, Erica and I looked at each other and said, I'm not sure at all. I have no idea what I'm going to say. And yesterday we said the same thing. I really have no idea what my remarks will be. And this morning, the same thing. We both looked at each other and said, I have no idea what my remarks will be. And now I realize that I was the only one telling the truth.
It's true.
So that's starting with a confession, but really on behalf of Erica and her wonderful insights and comments and our whole family, it means a great deal to have you here. And it's been over a month, and you know, I think we all have ups and downs, but certainly it's very, very touching to see the folks that are here. And so I'll have a few comments as well. But I do want to say one thing, that this was really a tragedy. And it was a tragedy in so many ways. And as part of that, you have horrible feelings, and we have horrible feelings, and they are feelings. And part of me always says feelings are a little overrated. And what matters is really choice. What matters are the decisions you make and where you go with your decisions. Stefan had not made any decision to leave us early, and so I'd rather focus today. And we've talked this over and over and over with our family, that this, we want this to be positive. We want to celebrate his life, not to mourn his passing. So that's when I look out here. For most of you, you've known him for a year, or you've known him his whole life, or you've known him in hockey, or you've known him in some other capacities. And, you know, so Stefan's kind of left his mark everywhere he went. And so I just want to thank, you know, there's a really a wide variety of impressions of Stefan in this group right here. But thank you for being here. I mean, there's so many families and coaches and his peers and friends and teachers and employers, and I mean, there's so many people to thank. And so, and you all know Stefan in slightly different ways. And I would, I guess, follow part of Erica's comments and say that he's in heaven right now, and I would love to see his dorm room there. I would love to see, you know, we know about his computing systems, we know about all that, but he'll have a lacrosse stick under the bed, he'll have his sailing gear hanging up on the wall, and there's a string of books about economics and self-improvement and math and coding and so on and so forth. And there's no food. He had a certain discipline about that. He wouldn't put any food in his dorm room. It's very interesting. A lot of you know parts of him. If you're from this area, you don't know that, you know, he went out to Cranbrook and he won a state championship in lacrosse his freshman year, and in his junior year he gave up lacrosse to learn sailing. He played ice hockey, but that really wasn't his passion as much as it was for some of his siblings. And his passion was much more on the maker side, the side of creating things, and made friends with people who had NC machines in their rooms and 3D printers and so on, and did a lot of that. If you're from around this area, you may know him in other capacities. You may know that cute smile that was you'd see on stage when he'd have one of his two or three broken arms and having his dummy sing Elton John songs as a kind of revenge for me for making him do that all the time. I flossed him as a child, I think. But he grew to absolutely love classical music, and when he learned saxophone, then he really focused on the trumpet. Just had an incredible passion for that, and would call me up and say, you got to listen to this. And it was some movement, a Tchaikovsky symphony, which he said, this is his latest. But he had a lot of courage, and he was always brave with strangers. He had a kind of blind spot. He didn't really ever understand who his peers were. So we might be out as a family walking around, and next thing I know, I look around and Stefan's with an elderly person sitting on the curb talking like a peer and asking them about, you know, how things are going. Just as he would be a great friend for all his buddies in the hockey team and so on. But he had a lot of very interesting elements to him, which honestly, it just brings joy to your heart just to keep going through these things. And some of you may know that women were crazy about Stefan. I don't know, women of all categories. When after the first week of his kindergarten at Challenger long ago, I talked to the principal that we had known for a number of years because of the others, that I said, how are things going with Stefan? And she looked at me and said, well, things are going pretty well. And I thought, wow, 1 week into kindergarten, he's already, you know, he's found something. And I said, well, it sounds like it's not perfect. What's going on? He said, well, we do have this kind of problem. Every time there's a recess, the kids can't get out of the room because all of the sixth grade girls are waiting outside the door. They're crowding around there for Stefan. So speaking as someone who never got a date before he was 30, I mean, Stefan was flirting with Miss Ecuador at age 5. So he taught me a great deal in a lot of other areas as well. I think it's very, there's an ebb and flow in this whole process. And I've mentioned this to a few people that there are times when you say, I don't know if I want to go to sleep because I don't want any more of those dreams. And then there are times when you wake up and say, oh, no, I'll take the dream any day. I don't want the reality. So it's one of these moments where you start thinking, what am I going to do with this? What am I going to do with these feelings, and what decisions am I going to make? And Stefan, he actually provides some guidance in those areas. So when we went to his room, and this was June, right after the June 7th, still remaining on his wall was a sheet of paper that he had written out. So I have a copy of this because it's a little bit roughed up now. But this paper represents Stefan's morning plan, what he did to organize himself every day. And while I think of this while I'm thinking about my own feelings and wallowing in my own decisions about what I'm going to do in these circumstances. So here was his, first of all, it says morning plan. And he makes a decision, like, what days is this going to apply to? And he wrote down Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday every week. So there are no respites from this program. It starts at 5 a.m., 5 a.m. to 5:07 a.m. Drink water, brush teeth. 5:07 to 5:10, get dressed for a run. Now remember, he's in Michigan, so this is every day of the 9 months that he was spending there. 5:10 to 5:40, exercise. In other words, run or anything, really. 5:40 to 5:55, shower, get dressed, drink water. 5:55 to 6:10, meditate and relax. 6:10 to 6:59 was plan your day, show appreciation, do something you enjoy, and after that, read. So I'm not sure whether those were the same things. 7 a.m., sign in at the dorm office. 7:01 to 7:15, eat breakfast. 7:15 to 7:35, mental stimulation. For example, code or read. And then 7:35 to 8 o'clock, prepare for the day and go to school. And at the bottom, he wrote his name and he signed it. So this was his contract with himself. So I was always amazed that that someone could be this motivated and structure their day and do these kinds of things. And I think the message there, think is, when in doubt, get up at 5, drink water, and go to school. And that's the, you know, kind of the example he set. And I loved him for his passion on these things, and you know, and it came out there. I could give remarks 1,000 times, and they would never be the same about Stefan. There's so many elements that I will miss and so many elements that we will celebrate. And I hope so many ways that he will affect your lives too. Stefan turned 17 on March 31st, and he passed away on June 7th, about a week later. And I wrote him a birthday letter. And so I'll read that to you. As I read it, I want you to imagine that this could have been given to him at age 25. It could have been given to him at age 18, at age 40. This was, I think, really more of a statement about Stefan than a birthday card. But I wrote, "Dear Stefan, there's so many things I could write about on your 17th birthday, so many thoughts going on in my mind about these past years. I could write how proud I am to have you as a son and how proud I am of what you are becoming as a person at your school and as part of the family. I could write about how you continue to reach past your fears and your doubts and still face your challenges head on, often with the extra courage of engaging others for help and support. I could also remind you of the special quality you have of not letting the fear of failure stop you, of knowing that you care more about effort and growth than about outcome. And of course, I could write about your good judgment toward others, your ability to surround yourself with great people and your innate kindness. But on this particular birthday, I just want to point out to you the amazingly positive impact that you've had on everyone around you for the past 17 years. And especially the love and the positive spirit you've shown, which has completely transformed my own happiness as a parent. You will never know how much you mean to me. All the great lives have not been lived yet. Stefan had a wonderful life, but he left bits and pieces behind for others, his peers, and even some of the older folks here. But you're still here, I'm still here, and we have a chance to be in that group. The greatest way to honor Stefan is with a fully lived life of your own. Surround yourself with great people. Serve them. I think many of you know the phrase that you're the product of the five people you spend the most time with. Maybe put Stefan on that list for a day every year on June 7th. Take a bit of his courage, a little bit of his smile, a little bit of his kindness, a little bit of his fearlessness, a little bit of his energy, and transform your day. But take some of it forward and use it. Some of his friends were hockey players. They know that you only have so many shifts in life and that you should skate them hard. The musicians know that you should not miss practice. And I think there's so many wonderful elements of the way he lived his life, which are great for us. And it is my mission to live my life fully and to take advantage of some of the things that I took away from 17 years with Stefan, which I wouldn't trade a second for, even knowing what's happened. So I didn't know what I was going to say, but I do still know that it means so much for us as a family to have you here. And your expression of support to this point and today is wonderful. I can't wait to see everybody at the reception afterwards. But thank you, and we move forward.
Erica and Alan, thank you. I'm sure all of us realize what a complicated, difficult thing that is to do, but what a great way to honor your son. Thank you for sharing that. Well, we're going to take a couple of moments and look at some pictures of Stefan's life. We've had pictures created by his mom and dad. Now we're going to see some physical pictures. sure, for all of us, there are lots of things that go through our mind when we look at pictures like that. The first thing I think about is how precious life is, and the relationships that we have, and the love that we share, and the things we say to each other. And then I think you look at the various ages of Stefan in that picture and how quickly it goes. It must be unbelievable for you as a family, how quickly that is all gone. Well, I'm gonna suggest that we just take a minute or two, just close your eyes, I'll have Barbary play, and just use this as a moment of saying thank you to the Lord for Stefan's life and how he touched you and what you remember of him, and just use it as a time of thanksgiving. Let's close our eyes just for a minute or two. And let me lead us in prayer. Gracious Father, at a service like this, we come with a sense of gratitude for the amazing gift of life and the fullness with which Stefan was able to live that life, albeit way, way, way too short. And one day we'll be able to ask you what this was all about. But right now, it's just a time of trust, and it's a time of understanding what Eric has said in relation to Revelation 21, that he's now safe and secure with you, and he has begun a whole new adventure. But Father, I pray for this family. I ask for your blessing upon them, for Ellen and Erica, for Hannah and Andrew and Keiko. I ask you that the images that we just saw and the words that we heard will stay close to their hearts and their minds. And indeed, June 7th will also be a day that we will remember and remember what a great gift you gave to this family and what a great gift you gave to the world in Stefan's life. We thank you that we have the security of knowing where he is. We thank you for your love and your grace. And we pray that you continue to fill us with that same Holy Spirit. We pray all these things in gratitude in the name of your Son and our Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, we are going to close our time together today by singing, because I think it's good for us. And we're going to stand together and sing this great hymn, Amazing Grace. Let's stand together and sing, please.
That saved a just did, that grace appear. The hour I first believed, through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home.
Well, on behalf of the family, let me again thank you for being here and taking just a couple of minutes out of your day and out of your week to be with them and to share your love and your support for them. Sure hope that all of you will be able to join us for a reception just across the breezeway, right immediately following the service. It will give you a chance to just kind of give them a hug and say hello to them and express your own thoughts to them. So again, thank you so much for coming. Receive now this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace, both now and forevermore. Amen.